What is church?
Is it a building?
With some pews?
A piano?
And stained glass?
Or is it something more?
2,000 years ago, the church was born.
It wasn't made up of the famous, the rich, or the powerful.
It was made up of everyday people who passionately believed in the message of Jesus.
It was the beginning of a revolution of love and freedom that would change the world forever.
In 369 AD, the church built the first hospital
as a place to care for those who cannot care for themselves. Today, the church is the largest single provider of healthcare in history.
The church was the first to stand up for the rights of children, creating the first and largest orphanage system in the world.
100 out of the first 110 universities in America
were founded as Christian institutions.
Places like Harvard,
Dartmouth,
Yale,
and Princeton.
Much of the world's greatest art,
architecture,
literature,
and music has been shaped by the church.
But the impact of the church isn't just ancient history.
Today, the church is stronger than ever
and continues to impact every corner of the world.
Over 300,000 churches in America
and almost 5 million churches around the world stand ready to be instruments of change, to do what governments could never do.
Every day, the church brings food and fresh water to millions of people across the world.
It has a renewed passion to help widows and orphans
and fights to free slaves in every part of the world.
It stands ready as a first responder on the scene to provide relief for victims of disaster.
The ripple of Jesus' impact can be clearly seen and felt in the church today.
And it's made up of people like me and you.
Today, you didn't just come to a building.
You came to a revolution 2,000 years in the making.
The world is facing as much trouble as ever.
But we are not afraid. We were created for such a time as this.
We will continue to do what we've always done.
Proclaim the message of Jesus
to help a world that needs him so desperately.
Welcome.
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 Welcome to church.
So awesome. Can we say thank you to our worship team? You guys are so amazing. Thank you so much. I've said this before, and I can say this. I always say that our worship team is the best worship team in the universe. And it's true, because you know what? We're just worshiping the King with all we got. Is that right? And praise the Lord. Thank you so much, worship team. You guys are absolutely amazing. So this, we're going to go through a new series starting today, and it's called just J316. This is the symbol. How many of you have seen this shirt around? Kind of seen it here and there, maybe? Okay, not too many, but we want to promote this, and this is why. The reason why is, first of all, behind this is like, what does this stand for? It stands for John 3:16. And so we're going to put that passage up of scripture up on the board. We're going to read that together, and then we're going to take it off the board, and we're going to quote it together. Is that okay?
Yeah.
So if it's up, let's go for it. Ready? Go.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Okay, so let's take it off, and let's do it together one more time, and as loud as you can. Ready? Go.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Cool, okay? So we want to continue to kind of work that. We want that to be a part of our, just built into our spirit. And so we want to understand God's love and God's love for us. And it may be for some of us like so simple, like, yeah, man, I already know God loves me, and that's so easy. But you'll be surprised how many people don't really know that, bless you. And how many people think that God is angry, and God can be angry. We can make God upset, and God might be like after us, and it's just absolutely not true. So the reason for this campaign, and we have some of these shirts and things like that for sale for you, if you're interested. There's no pressure to purchase these things, but if you want to. And the reason why this is, I thought it would be a good idea, is because it gives you the opportunity to present the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we were prophesied over earlier this year, right, that this is the year of the greatest sermon ever told. A sermon that's going to be told through your life and through the things that you do. So, if you're wearing this shirt, right, and it happens all the time, I'm just wearing this shirt, minding my own business, and somebody will say, oh, that's a cool shirt. what does that mean? It's like, boom, green light, here we go, right? And so somebody says, like, what does that mean? And so there's so many different ways for you to respond to that. One great way would just be to say, hey, did you know that God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life? It's just it just opens everything up. And they may say yes, they may say no, they may look at you kind of like, what? And you just say, oh, this right here, this represents a scripture in the Bible, John 3:16, which says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, right? And you just go into that scripture, and that will cause conversation for you to just share the gospel with somebody. Is that a good idea? Mm-hmm. It's a great idea. And so we want to encourage that. And on top of that, so the second part of it is that we want to collectively as a church understand that scripture, understand God's love, and go through an entire series of just knowing that, getting that revelation from God to us. And so here we go. We're going to start this whole series, J3:16, okay? And so let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this morning. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. And we pray, Holy Spirit, that you would have your way this morning, that you would speak to us, that you would give us ears to hear you, and that you would give us eyes to truly see and hearts of courage to respond to your word. And as I get out of your way, Holy Spirit, would you please speak this message to us? Light us aflame and light us afresh and move us and cause us to be more and more like you. We're so excited about what you're about to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so we don't want to be afraid of preaching the gospel. So we want to encourage everybody to throw on a shirt if you can and just walk around. You just become like a billboard for Jesus, and we want to encourage that. In Romans 1:16, this is what it says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek." That means for everyone, okay? So how many of you are up to that? You're okay with preaching the gospel? Okay, great. I can't see everybody, but I'm just going to believe that all your hands are up. Very good. Okay. So we want to spend this next season just focusing on the love of God. Okay. Just focusing on the love of God. And this is a really important thing that we kind of grasp together. We want to understand the love of God, the love that God has for us according to his word. Not according to the relationships that you have. Many times what we do is we relate the relationships that we have and we relate that with God. We say, like, oh, my dad was a scrub. You know, he wasn't ever home. He used to beat me up. He was always mean. He was always drinking. So in some people's minds, fathers are bad. And so when you say, like, hey, did you know you have a heavenly father who loves you so much? They can't comprehend that. They're like, what? Like, all I know about fathers is that they don't come home and they don't fulfill their promises and they abandon people. That's all I know about fathers, right? And so we want to make sure that the relationship that we know and build and understand about who God is and the love that he has for you comes from the Bible, and that we don't equate God with the kind of relationships that we have. We don't want to pull him down into our own knowledge and understanding in our own way and just bring God to that place. We want to understand who he is and how much he loves us according to his word. Okay? So when we talk about the love of God, we talk about love. There's a whole bunch of different loves and a whole bunch of different emotional loves. In the Greek language, they're broken up into a few different words. And so I'll go through that really quick. First of all, there's a love called a phileo kind of love, okay? And that's like a brotherly love. That's the kind of love that like friends have together. It's like, hey, buddy, let's hang out and let's like work out together. Or let's like women, maybe like let's go shopping together, or go to the movies or etc. Right? It's like that kind of friendship. And we just like love each other. We're like buddies and we're like friends, okay? But that's an emotional kind of love. It's like if I'm a good friend to you, you're a good friend to me, and then we're good. And then we love each other in that way. A storge kind of love is a family kind of love. That's where daddy loves his daughter and mommy loves her son. And everybody just, we have this family time together. We always do everything together. And there's love that takes place there. When dad is a good dad, oh, I love my dad because he's awesome, right? It's a storge kind of love. But that's a love that also is dependent upon emotion, okay? An eros kind of love, and that's where we get the word erotic from, so excuse that, but it's a kind of lovey-dovey kind of, and I'm going to keep this G-rated, a lovey-dovey kind of like kissy-kissy kind of love, where that's how they know that kind of love, and it's kind of like a physical thing, but that is also an emotional kind of love, okay? But the kind of love that God has for us is a love called agape. Can you say agape? An agape kind of love is a love birthed out of choice. That means emotions are not involved with that. When emotions start pulling us and it makes us make all these decisions because we're emotionally drawn, that's not how it is for God. He chooses to love us, regardless of how good you are, how bad you are, the things that you've done, the things that you've done in your past, the things that you think about, the horrible things that you've done, etc. He just chooses to love you. And that's the kind of love that we want to understand and we want to know and we want to actually operate by ourselves, okay? So in 1 John 4:16, this is what it says. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. Everybody say, God is love. And he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. So if God is love, and he is, according to the word of God, here are some scriptures that would maybe help us make a little bit of sense, okay? In 1 Corinthians 13:4-8, this is like kind of like the love scripture, right? Where we kind of understand love. And so I'll read it to you real quick, and then we'll kind of like insert God to be there. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Okay? So the Word of God says that God is love. So we could say this: God is patient. And how many of you know how patient God is with you, right? How long has it taken for the Lord to get our attention? And sometimes we want somebody to just move. We want somebody to do something because we know it's the right thing. It's like, come on already. Like, how long is it going to take? And at the same time, if we understand that God has been patient with us, and so patient with us, that that should bleed into us, and that it would give us the opportunity to be patient towards others. So God is patient. God is kind. He does not envy. He does not boast. He is not proud. He does not dishonor others. He is not self-seeking. He is not easily angered. And he keeps no record of wrongs, especially for us who are in Christ Jesus. Not only keeps no records of wrongs, there is none, because the blood of Jesus Christ has taken that away. Say amen to that. That is super awesome. All right. Love does not delight, or God does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. God always protects, he always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. And God never fails. That is just to get us started, okay? We want to understand what the Bible says about love, and what the Bible says about that love that God has for us. And we don't want it to be one-dimensional. A lot of times what we do is we just paint this picture and say, oh yeah, God loves me, and like, he's cool, and like, whatever. And he has so many different dimensions to himself, and so we're going to go through that, okay? So why is this important? Why is this important for us to understand God's love for us? Our understanding and experience of God's love plays a huge part in our love, acceptance, and relationship towards others. Did you know that the way that we see God loving us is the way that we actually treat other people and how we love them? The way that we see God towards us many times is how we actually operate towards others. So the greater revelation that we have of how much God loves us, it changes us. We don't want to just hear stuff and like forget, right? We want to hear God's word, and we want to allow that to change us so that we could be more like him, that we could be the person that he's created us to be. Would you agree with that? Amen. All right, very good. So here's in 1 Timothy 1:5, this is what it says. Now the purpose of the commandment is love from a pure heart, from a good conscience, and from sincere faith. Okay, great. And 1 John 4:19 says, we love him because he first loved us. So in this passage, what we're saying is that you cannot give away what you don't have. You cannot withdraw what hasn't been deposited. So we must understand how much he loves us so that we can withdraw from that account so that we could give to others. Does that sound like a good idea? I think so. Okay, so here are a few facets. And there's no way that we could cover all the different dimensions that God has and his love for you in one sitting. So we're going to go through a few. And first of all, God's love acts. Okay? That means that God's love is active, and it's active towards you. In Romans 5:8, this is what it says. But God demonstrates his own love toward us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Okay? I know we've read that scripture before, and the G-rated version is, God died for us, Jesus died for us, God gave his son for us when our hand was in the quote-unquote cookie jar, right? When we were like sinning, like, oh, I'm so bad, I'm a sinner, right? And we use that cookie jar idea, and that makes a, you know, that makes a lot of sense, but I would encourage us to truly understand what this passage of scripture is saying. When we were dirty, when we were at our worst, when we were worthless, when we had done nothing good, and we were just standing there with nothing to offer, completely empty, that is when God looked at us and made a decision to love us. That is when God made a decision to love you, is at your very, very worst. And he knew everything about you. He knew what you were about to do, and he loved you anyway. We're going to take a look at this video clip that we've used a while back. I think it was a year or two ago when we went through the book of Hosea. And the book of Hosea speaks about this prophet, and God tells this prophet, Hosea, I want you to marry this woman. And she's a beautiful woman, but what happens is her heart is not for her husband. Her heart is for herself. And Gomer, that's her name, she's a beautiful woman, but she turns into a prostitute, and she does all these horrible, horrible things. And she breaks the prophet's heart over and over again, and he continues to love her. So as you're reading the story, you're like, why do you keep loving her? Like, just cancel her. It's like, turn her off a cliff, right? She's so unfaithful. She's just gross. She does her own things. She's selfish, 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 only thinks about herself. And as you're reading the story, you're thinking to yourself, Jose, just let this lady go. Just drop kick her off the face of the earth, right? She's like, boo, right? And at the same time, God says, the reason why we have those stories in the Bible is so that we could understand how God loves you. And so, without any further ado, we're going to take a look. It's only it's the first clip of this series that we've gone through, but I thought maybe we could pull that out of the archive to help prove this point. So, let's take a look at this. Thank you. I meant to mention to you that as we watch this clip, it's a rendition, a modern rendition of a Bible story found in Hosea. And so in this clip, we see how this couple, they get married. And so this gentleman, of course, represents Hosea, and she represents Gomer in the Bible. And the idea for this whole thing is that this guy, he just like loves his wife, right? And they get married, and there's so much anticipation, and there's so much love, and there's so much joy, and there's so much future, and there's so much hope, and all of a sudden, everything just crashes. Everything just crashes down. And I'm wondering if you have ever been in that position too, where you felt like, you know what, I'm just gonna give up. I had so much expectation, I had so much hope, and I just thought it was gonna really work out, and then all of a sudden it just doesn't. And somebody stabs you in the back, and you just feel like, you know what, I'm just gonna let go, I'm done, I'm gonna give up, I've had enough, I can't continue any longer, and you just wanna be like, I'm gonna let this go, right? At that very place, was when Jesus, when God looked at you, and we were that person. We were that person who was causing that kind of harm. And it was at that very moment when God said, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna drop kick you off the face of the earth. I'm not gonna burn you to the, you know, into like a little piece of coal or whatever. I'm going to choose to love you. I'm going to choose to give my son for you. It was at that place of disappointment, that place of lowness, that place of sin in our lives, that God decided to love us. Does that help us understand a little bit about the love that He has for us? It's absolutely true. And that's the kind of love that God has for us. And let's continue on. God's love acts. That was the first part. And listen to this. God's love acts towards you, not when you're like doing like good stuff. Not like when you're like feeding the homeless or like doing church stuff and ministry work and like, look, Lord, look all these things I'm doing for you. That's not when God moved for you. That's not when God loved you so much to move for you. God loved you and moved for you when you were at your very worst. Okay? And the reason why we want to understand that is because it helps us understand the kind of love that God has for you. Say amen to that. Amen. It's true. God's love doesn't only act, but God's love is personal. It's personal towards you, okay? Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God. And let's read this together, church, if we could. Who loved me and gave himself for me. Okay, let's do it all together from the who loved me part. Ready? Go. Who loved me and gave himself for me. Here's the one thing about Scripture that we want to really, 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 really understand is that Scripture is not for, say, the Apostle Paul. We can read this passage of Scripture and say, like, oh yeah, of course God loved the Apostle Paul because they're like, you're a godly dude and like you help write like the whole New Testament, you know, for the most part. Of course God loves you. Or you can look at somebody else and say, like, yeah, look, he's like a person of God. Yeah, of course God loves them. But here's the thing. We need to read the Bible and you need to read these things and know that when it says, who loved me and gave himself up for me, it has to be personal, because his love for you is extremely personal. He wants you to know his love for you. He wants you to respond to that love. He wants you to understand these things. And it's just absolutely, absolutely true. So it's personal. It's between you and Jesus. The love that he has for you is between you and Jesus, not between you and grandma. Because grandma, of course, grandma goes to church. She went to church like for 50,000 years, right? So yeah, of course, she's filled with faith and God loves grandma. Or God loves mom or grandpa or my dad or pastor or all these kind of people. It's not between, God's love is not between you and them. And God's love is between you and the Lord. It has to be personal. You have to open up and receive the love that he has for you. He wants to reach in and he wants to be personal with you. Okay? That is a very big deal. Big deal, big deal, big deal. So everything we're talking about, all these things apply to you. Okay? So God's love is eternal. Okay? So not only does God's love act, and not only is God's love personal, but God's love is eternal. Romans 8:38 to 39, this is what it says. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is what this passage of Scripture is saying. When you're in Christ Jesus, right? When you become one with Christ Jesus, there's nothing that can separate the love of God, the love that God has for you. Nothing, okay? Nothing, as in there's nothing, okay? Really important. We want, because here's the thing is that we think that we can do a whole bunch of things to get out of God's love. We think if we do something wrong, if we lie, if we, you know, if we do something, there's always something that we think that if we do something wrong, God's going to stop loving us. And God's going to look at us and be the, like that, right? And it's just absolutely not true. By the way, what did the gecko say to the other gecko when he fell off the two-story building? I just remember that. Sorry. Okay. Let's continue on. Okay. But here's the thing, right? Is that God's love for you, it won't stop. And by the way, God's love for every single person that you know, God's love is the same for them, no matter what they've done and etc. God loves them just as much as God loves you. Okay, I'm praying that as we receive this, that you just would have a deeper revelation of how much God loves you. And as you receive that revelation, when you walk out of church, you need to know that God loves that person who doesn't want to have anything to do with God, who's always rude, who's always mean, who's always blaspheming, who's always cussing, who's always swearing, etc. God doesn't love you any more than he loves that person. God loves all of us with that same kind of love. Okay, so let's please remember that. And so anyway, God's love is eternal, and there's nothing that you can do to make him stop loving you. There's nothing that you can do. And as this series continues, we'll talk about these things, because I know a lot of people, they would say to me right now, they would raise their hand and say like, oh no, pastor, there's a scripture that says that, you know, that you could like blaspheme the Holy Spirit and he'll like you know, kind of like kick you off or throw you into the lake of hell or whatever, right? All these kind of things. And right now, what we want to focus on is the love that God has for you. I had the privilege to do a wedding. Our cousin got married in Kauai, so we were in Kauai, and I just conducted the wedding. It was just a wonderful, wonderful time in the Lord. But do you see, like, as we're talking about love and talking about commitment, talking about covenant, talking about vows, do you think it would be a good idea for me to, during that time, say, by the way, there's this thing called divorce, and so if you don't listen, you guys might get divorced. Yeah, so try not to get divorced, okay? Because, you know, does that sound like a good idea? No, that sounds like absolutely stupid. And I would never do that, okay? And so likewise, as we're talking about the love that God has for you, let's just focus on the love that God has for you. Is that okay? Okay, great. Okay, so let's continue on. God's love is to be known and experienced. Okay, known and experienced. God's love will change us. And the deeper revelation that we have in God's love, it actually changes everything. It changes our dynamic in faith. It changes our dynamic in forgiveness. It changes pretty much everything. So we want to, God's love is to be known and experienced. In Ephesians 3, 17 through 19, this is what it says. That Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints, that means all the people that we're sitting together, that we could understand his love together, that we could know his love together. And we believe that's what a church is for. We need to gather together so we could know God, right? That makes pretty easy sense there. Let me see where, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width, the length, the depth, and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Here it is. When you can receive God's love, that's when you can begin to be filled with the fullness of God. But at the same time, his love is so tremendous. His love is so deep, so wide, so long, and so tall. It's actually like we'll spend our entire lifetime on earth trying to understand all these things. And his love is that good. His love is that amazing towards you. Isn't that awesome? I think that's awesome. I can't see your faces, but I'm hoping everybody's smiling. Okay, whatever. Okay? So, We'll talk through some of these things. And like I was saying, we don't want to think of God's love as just one-dimensional. A lot of times we think like God's love is like just a painting. Like, let's just paint the picture like right on the wall. Like, yeah, okay, that's what God's love looks like. But it's not. It's multi-dimensional. There's all these different facets of God and all these different. And that's why he has so many different names and how he reaches out to us and how he communicates with us and how we know him in so many different ways. And it's so true. And so in his love, it's the same way too. So the width of God's love. Let's talk about that for a second. So we're going to talk about the width of God's love, the length of God's love, the depth of God's love, and the height of God's love, okay? As found in here in this scripture in Ephesians 3. So the width of God's love is this. It includes everyone. Okay, it includes everyone. It's just like, it's as wide as can be. It doesn't matter what color we are. It doesn't matter where we come from. It doesn't matter how old we are. It doesn't matter what sex we are. None of that matters. His love is wide, okay? And it goes everywhere. It will touch everyone. So that's why we want to wear these shirts or just do whatever we want to do to present the gospel, because everybody qualifies to receive this love from God. Okay?
Yes.
Okay, very good. Okay, sounds like you guys are, I'm just like preaching to the choir. You guys are like, yeah, I already know this stuff, bro. Okay, sorry. So it's that width, okay? It's the width of God's love. It's everywhere, all right? The length of God's love, okay? This is so cool, okay? His love goes from eternity to eternity. Did you know that God loved you? Okay, we're talking about love, right? He loved you before the formation of the world. And this is what this means, is that when we read through history, right? So even though when we read the Bible, we read about all these different things, and like during the flood and all these things in the Bible we read about. It's like history, or even if we look into history, here's what we can know, that as history was taking place, all the things found in history, God knew you and God was thinking about you before all that even started. And that is it. That's a tremendous, tremendous thought for me to carry around, to know, like, as we look through history, we look through all the things that God has done, that He, in the back of His mind, He had me in mind somewhere there, and He had you in mind somewhere there too. Say, that's cool. That's cool, okay? Ephesians 1, 4 through 5. Even before He made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in His eyes. How can you not just think that's amazing? That is amazing. First of all, if you believe the Bible, and if you believe the Bible is true, which it is, then when you read these scriptures and it's speaking about you, and it really, really is, it should light up this kind of revelation, like, holy smoke, like, God was thinking about me all the way from before the foundation of the world. And yes, he was. God decided in advance to adopt us into His own family by bringing us to Himself through Jesus Christ. And there's this whole thing about adoption. Some people say, like, oh, you know, how come I have to be adopted for? Why can't I just be a son? The thing about adoption is that there's this whole thing about choice. It's like, I choose you. God chose you. He did it. It's not like He had to. Like, for us who have kids and stuff like that, like, we gotta love them, right? Because that's our kids, right? We give birth to these children, and like, that's our kids, and so we love them because it's ours. We gotta love them. But at the same time, when there's adoption, it's like we go out and we look out, and it's like, man, you know, I don't know your history, I don't know what kind of issues you may have, but I love you, and I'm gonna love you, and I'm gonna love you. There's this whole thing about adoption, and that's the kind of love that God has for us. He knew you before the foundation of the world, and He chose you, and He said, you are gonna be mine. I'm going to bring you into my family. And that shouldn't make us feel like kind of like on the outside. That should make us totally feel like we're on the inside of God's heart, the inside of God's thoughts. And that is just amazing, without a doubt. Okay, God decided in advance to adopt us into His own family by bringing us to Himself through Jesus Christ. This is what He wanted to do, and it gave Him great pleasure. Let's remember this. As we talk about the love of God, And as God's love is being highlighted, it expresses who He is. It has nothing to do with us. Did we deserve to be loved like that? Did we deserve to be saved? Did we deserve all these things that we receive? We don't. There's nothing that we did that qualifies us for God to love us. He just loves us. And so what we want to do is we want to understand that love and consent to it. And we want to say, like, I receive it, I understand it, and I'm going to let this move my heart, and I'm going to be different for it. That's cool. That is just cool. Let's just say that's cool. Okay. So the depth. Okay. So that was the length. So here's the depth. The depth of God's love is shown in the depth of what He's gone through to forgive all of us of our sin. All the worst things that you could ever think about that all mankind has ever done and will ever do, but those who have called upon the name of Jesus Christ, Jesus has dealt with sin altogether. It's already finished. Do you agree with that? It's a big deal, because as I sit down with like other people and we're talking about the kingdom of God and all these kind of things, some pastors will say, like, you know, the problem is sin. The problem is sin in this world. There's so much sin, and we need to deal with sin in her life and deal with sin in his life. And sin, sin, sin. Right? And I'm like, no, the problem is not sin. And you'll see all these eyes, it's like burning red. Right? They're looking at me like, like, yes, it is, you little person. Like, you don't know. It's sin, because people have been parroting that forever. It's like sin. Here's our position. The issue that we have to solve as a church, as a body of Christ, is not sin. It's not sin. And here's why. Because if we say we have to deal with sin, then what we are saying is that Jesus Christ wasn't enough. When you died on the cross, it wasn't enough. I need to help out, right? It's like, really? What do you think you are, right? Jesus Christ, the finished work on the cross is finished. And it is done, and it is finished, and it is, to tell us, it's just completely done. Jesus Christ has dealt with sin, okay? These are just facts. The problem that we need to solve as a church, as a collectively, as a body of Christ, is for people to know Jesus. The reason why people don't go to heaven is not because of their sin and all this stuff, or it's because they don't know Jesus. They need to have a relationship with Jesus, declare him as Lord and Savior, and that is what moves us. That is the problem that we need to solve. That's what, it's a good idea to wear the shirts. Okay, just put on a shirt, just put it on, and just kind of like preach the gospel and share with them. We need to have people know and understand the love that God has for them and what he has already done for them. It's already finished. So sin is a done deal because of what Jesus Christ has done. So don't let anybody say, like, oh, you need to deal with this, and you need to deal with that. It's just a revelation of Jesus Christ. When you have a deep revelation of his love for you, it changes everything. Because I'm like following Jesus. I'm like, I just want to do what God wants me to do. And I'm just like following that light. All the yuckiness, all the poor decisions, all the sin, it doesn't even appeal. I'm just following the Lord by spirit, okay? I'm not saying, like, here's your list of things you can't do and all these kind of things. No, and that's why the love of Jesus Christ, the love of God, is proven in the depth of his love for us. And it's proven in the sin that he's wiped out, taken away for all of us. And so that's why we need to subscribe to that. We need to tell people about that. Say amen to that.
Amen.
Let's do it. Let's do that together, okay? So here's the next thing, the height of God's love. Not only did Jesus take all of our sin and the depth and go into hell and take all the keys, right, and all these kind of things, and so that's like the depth of his love. But the height of his love is that after that, in heaven, we sit in the same places. He's given us this place and position in heaven that we sit with him. And do you see, like, all these different things? He didn't have to do any of that stuff for us. None of it. But he loves you that much. That is so cool. It's just amazing. Okay. Ephesians 2:6 is what it says. And raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. The more we get a deeper revelation of who Jesus is, and the more we can understand, like, all that Jesus is and all that he has done, and then when we understand that we have been grafted in, okay, so we are one with Jesus, right? Before we were born again, separated, right, and our spirit was dead, and then when we were born again, the Spirit of God comes inside of us, we become one with Jesus. And why that is so important is because the way that the Father sees Jesus is the way that the Father sees you, as righteous, as blessed, as favored, as anointed, you name it, and all those different things. So the more we understand these things, the more it'll give us freedom to live a life that's free from sin, to live a holy life, to be doing what God's called us to do, a freedom and liberty and all these different things. And it all starts with understanding the kind of love that he has for us. And so anyway, that height, right? He's brought us into this place of seating with Christ Jesus in heavenly places. And in the next few weeks, we're going to talk a little bit about the government of heaven and the courts of heaven. And you're going to be totally blown away. I promise. And we're going to see how much God loves us and all the benefits that we have as sons and daughters of Jesus Christ. All right. So here's the next thing. Okay. And we're almost done. The Father loves you as much as he loves Jesus. Okay. How many of you believe that? Okay, see? Okay. Let's read this passage of scripture, and before we do, let's just open ears. Father, in Jesus' name, as we read this passage of scripture, I just rebuke right now any doubt, any unbelief that would try to hinder us, Lord, from the very truth that you have for us, the very lies and the strategies of the enemy that would try to hold these things back and that has held us, so many of us, back for so long. We break that right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, John 17, this is Jesus Christ praying for his disciples, and he's actually praying for you. Okay, so when Jesus was on earth, he actually prayed for us. That is just amazing on so many different levels. We understand that death and life are found in the power of the tongue, and he that loves it shall eat the fruit thereof. When Jesus was on earth, he was releasing blessing and favor over all the generations that would come, and that includes us that are sitting here this morning. And so that's always, when we get into John 17, that's like one of my favorite things to talk about. But let's get into this truth that we need to receive. I do not pray for these alone, and Jesus is talking about his disciples at the time, but also for those who will believe, that's you, in me through their word. And that's through the works of the disciples and what they're about to do. That they all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you. They're one, right? That they also may be one in us. That the world may believe that you sent me. And the world will believe when we share the gospel with the world, all right? And the glory which you gave me, I have given them, that they may be one just as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. Okay? That is a big amen right there. It's like, boom, amen. Okay? So what Jesus is talking about, this unity, that as I'm in you and you're in me, like we're one. And all of these people, that's all of you, when we are all grafted into, we all become one. And this is the kind of love that God has for us. It's not like a love like, I kind of like, I love you, but then you guys, I love you guys and I love you so much, but I love you maybe just like a two notches down from like how I love my special person, right? Nope. He's saying, I love you all at the same place. The same love that the Father has for Jesus, he has for you. Now, this is the point where you have to get this part out of your brain where you're thinking like, that's really true, you know. Oh, I know that's what the scripture says. Oh, I don't know if it's really true. It's really true. Okay, so you really have to receive this and really believe it. These revelations, as we continue to grow in this revelation, you're going to see supernatural things happen in your life. And you're going to see changes happen that can only happen when we have a revelation of the love that God has for us and as we move in it. So the same love that God the Father has for Jesus, he has for you. And that alone should just be completely, completely tremendous. And it should move us to be a completely different person. And this brings us right back to J3:16, to this whole little series that we're going through. And I know it's just like a little symbol, but it represents so much. It represents what the Bible is saying to us in such a big and major, major way, the love that God has for us. John 3:16. And we'll read this all together. We'll put it up if you would. And if I can invite the worship team to come up, please, that would be wonderful. Church, let's read this all together. Ready, go. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. How many of you believe that? Amen? Do you believe that? How many of you believe that God loves you? And this is the hashtag, by the way, for today, okay? If you need a hashtag for today, hashtag God loves me, okay? Because here's the thing, is so many times we go to church and we're like, wow, what did you learn at church? It's like, I don't know. It was good. I mean, the pastor was like, you know, he said some cool things, but I don't really remember what I learned at church. This is what we learned today. God loves me, okay? God loves you. And he so, so, so loves you, and he always has. And the thing is, we just need to understand that the Bible has been trying to reveal that to us this whole time. And when we can respond to that, and when our hearts resonate with his love, and when we can consent to that, that's when Jesus carries us. That's when we are weak, that he's strong, because we now consent to that love. We trust him. Nowhere in the Bible does it say to trust any other person. And the Bible doesn't say trust your pastor, trust your spouse, trust your church, trust this organization, trust the government, or whatever, right? The Bible only says to trust in the Lord. And the reason why is because he is trustworthy and because of the love that he has for you. Say, I am loved. I'm loved by God. I'm God's favorite. You are. You are, you are, you are. God so loves you. Amen. Church, can we all stand together, please? And would you grab a hold of the hand next to you as we conclude this morning? How many of you are blessed?
Amen.
Amen. Let's bow our heads this morning. Father, we thank you so much for your unconditional love for every single one of us. We pray, Lord, for an encounter, a continued encounter, Lord, as your word is just revealing to us complete truth. Lord, as we walk out this morning, that your Holy Spirit would continue to follow us and continue to pursue us, that we would see you in all the different aspects of our life, and that we would know with beyond a shadow of a doubt that you love us. You so love us. You loved us from before the foundations of the world. You loved us and you acted when you gave your only begotten Son. And when Jesus Christ died for every single one of us, you knew exactly what you were doing and you did it anyway. While we were yet sinners, while we were dirty, while we were worthless, while we were empty and have nothing to offer, that's when you moved. That's because that's how amazing you are. That's because of the amazing grace that you have towards your people, because of the amazing mercy and the amazing love, that unconditional love that you have towards us. And Father, we thank you for revealing that to us this morning. We consent to your love and we consent to you. Move in us, have your way. We subscribe completely to you. Father, we speak forth blessing right now in the name of Jesus over every single person that's here. That you would bless us as we come and bless us as we go. That you would bless us in the country and bless us in the city. That all the things that our hands touch, that it would prosper. All the questions that we have, Lord, that you would usher to us answers. And we thank you, Lord, so much for that. We give you praise. We give you honor this morning in your house. Thank you for loving us. We love you too. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody says, amen and amen. God bless you, church. Love you guys.